everywhere around the world. They come to America every time that flag's unfurled. They come to America. Got a dream to take them there. They come to America. Got a dream they come to share. They come to America. They come to America. They come to America. They come to America. They come to America today. Country, tis of thee,
today.
Sweet land of liberty,
today.
Of thee I sing,
today.
Of thee I sing,
today.
flag you'll be led by Mr. Abraham Lincoln. Please face the flag at the end of the football field.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please remain standing for the playing of the national anthem by the Junior High School Band. Mr. Owens.
Thank you.
Although Abraham Lincoln was not alive when the Constitution was written, we do feel that his presence represents many of the freedoms expressed in the Constitution. We've asked him to read a special message today to all students and faculty. Mr. Lincoln. Pardon me, man. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for inviting me to this celebration which honors the 200th anniversary of the United States Constitution. You are probably wondering what Abraham Lincoln is doing here. Where do I fit in exactly? I was born 22 years after the Constitution was written. I am not a founding father, and I'm not a framer of the Constitution. But if you stop and think a minute, I was president at a time when the United States was engaged in civil war. I would like to think that my leadership during the Civil War was strong enough to allow the United States to stay united. Yes, I've been accused of tearing a few holes in that Constitution. My critics called me a simple Susan tyrant. Maybe I was on occasion a man who had a tight grip on the reins of power. After all, the Civil War erupted at a time when Congress was not in session. I had to act fast to save the Union. Being president was a burden enough, but a wartime president was a tremendous responsibility. Why were we fighting? One of the reasons for the Civil War was the interpretation of the United States Constitution. Were we a nation of states or a nation of individuals? Were states superior to the Constitution? Could states nullify the Constitution? My answers to these questions are an emphatic no. It is not the case in this great land of ours that the states can claim to be superior to the superior law of the land. Although I violated the United States Constitution and set a number of precedents during the Civil War, most of my actions were later verified by the Supreme Court. I upheld the United States Constitution, yet I violated the United States Constitution. I give no excuses, except one important point I would like to make at this time. Once the Union was preserved, and the United States Constitution was preserved, once the concept of federalism was preserved, I would begin to refrain from iron-handed authority. That, of course, was my plan. Fortunately, the infractions were accepted, for the most part, by the Congress. Fortunately, the Constitution is intact. Fortunately, we are here today to celebrate the United States Constitution. It has been a long 200 years. I would like one final thing. As we pay homage to the remarkable men who assembled in Philadelphia 200 years ago, we should never delude ourselves. In one fell swoop, they secured the blessings of liberty for themselves and their posterity. The nation has been working at that ever since. And no one knows that better than myself. Thank you. One of the events that has taken place during this week-long constitutional celebration has been a constitutional poster contest. It's my pleasure to read those constitutional poster contest winners: Tom Lanning, Ann McWilliams, Norman Arston, Chris McKinney, Molly Pierce, Clara Canary, Christy Freeman, Allison Meyer, Nicholas Simak, Brittany Wilcoxon, and Tamara Johnson. Please give them a hand for their efforts. I have a representative from each of the school buildings in Ball Chatham District Number 5. They're going to come forward and read the preamble to the Constitution in unison. We have representing third grade at Chatham Elementary, Ryan Rivera. Representing fifth grade at Ball, Jim Hope. Representing the junior high, an eighth grader, Candy Bumgardner. Representing the high school, the president of the senior class, Mr. Kent Gray. Will those students please come forward?
Stand. Part of the ceremony.
representing the flags of the United States. We're asking the fourth graders to release the red, white, blue, blue. Hold them up at this time.
Union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and ensure the liberty for ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America.
Cherish we can and be.
course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal stations which have connected them to another. They should then declare the cause which impelled them into the separation.
We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We therefore do solemnly publish and declare that these united colonies are, and of right ought to be, free and independent states. And for the support of this declaration, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor.
Will you please stand for our national anthem?
Thank you. music with echoes of the past and sounds of hope for the future. One of the most beautiful of all American songs was written by a young English teacher as she sat viewing the world from the highest mountaintop in Colorado. Surrounded by the grandeur of jagged mountain peaks and the beauty of spacious skies, Catherine Lee Bates offered our nation these immortal words.
Whoa, ha! Arizona, Arkansas, California, Colorado, and Connecticut, and more. Delaware, Florida, Georgia, then Hawaii, Idaho, Illinois, Virginia, Iowa, still 35 to go. Kansas and Kentucky, Louisiana, Maine, Maryland, Massachusetts, and good old Michigan, Minnesota, Mississippi, Missouri, and my... Next, New Hampshire and New Jersey, and we're down in Mexico. New York, North Carolina, North Dakota, Ohio, Oklahoma, Oregon, Pennsylvania, now let's see. Rhode Island, South Carolina, South Dakota, Tennessee. Texas and the Utah, Vermont, I'm almost through. Virginia, then there's Washington, and there's Virginia too. Come on, Wisconsin, be the last one, or is it 49? No, Wyoming is the last state in the 50 states of time. Alaska, Arizona, Arkansas, California, Colorado, and Connecticut, and more. Delaware, Florida, Georgia, then Hawaii, Idaho, Illinois, Indiana, Iowa, still 35 to go. Kansas, like Kentucky, Louisiana, Maine, Maryland, Massachusetts, and good old Michigan, Minnesota, Mississippi, Missouri, and Montana, then Nebraska's 27, number 20 is Nevada. Next, New Hampshire and New Jersey, and we're down to Mexico. Then you know, North Carolina, North Dakota, Ohio, Oklahoma, Oregon, Pennsylvania, now let's see. Rhode Island, Pennsylvania, South Dakota, Tennessee, Texas, and there's Utah, Oklahoma, I'm almost through. Virginia, then there's Washington, and there's Virginia, too. Can Wisconsin be the last one, or is it 49? No, Wyoming is the last state in the 50 states of rhyme.
The true expression of the people.
We pass it down year after year, note by note, generation to generation. And then a remarkable phenomenon occurs. These simple homemade hand-me-downs emerge from relative obscurity and step into the bright light of fame we know as folk songs.
Join us on a nostalgic trip across the country, east to west, north to south, and sing along with the music of America.
From Alabama, with a banjo on my knee, and go to Louisiana, march to the port to sea.
Oh,
Majestically from New York Harbor is the colossal copper statue of a lady. In her right hand she holds aloft a flaming torch, a lamp shining with such brilliance that it is a beacon of hope to the farthest corners of the earth. The lady's name is Liberty.
Casting a sense of sudden greatness on all who behold her, this tall, beautiful statue stands draped in the noble dreams of free hearts everywhere. Her enormous expression is not one of force, but of freedom. Not one of power, but of love. For somehow, when we gaze into her eyes, she makes us feel the magnificence of being human.
For over 100 years, this stirring symbol has graced the gateway to our homes, endearing herself warmly in our hearts, ever reminding us of the very essence to which we owe our allegiance. Shine far, dear lady. Shine free forever.
Like the brazen giant of Greek fame, with conquering limbs astride from shore to shore, here at our sea-washed sunset gates shall stand a mighty woman with a torch, whose flame is the imprisoned lightning, and her name, Mother of Exiles. From her beacon hand blow worldwide welcome. Her mild eyes command the air-bridged harbor the Twin Cities frame. Keep ancient story your storied pomp, cries she with silent lips. Give me your tired, your poor,
your huddled mass is yearning to breathe free. The wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed to me. I lift my lamp beside the golden door. Freedom. When we consider the untold numbers of men and women who chose to set aside their personal ambitions and dreams to reassure the well-being of a nation, we stagger at the eternal debt we owe. We are indeed the beneficiaries of those who have made and will continue to make tremendous sacrifices for the advancement and surety of our liberty.
Forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather, to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is, rather, for us to be here dedicated to the great task which remains before us. That from these honored dead we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave their last full measure of devotion. That we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain. That this nation, under God, shall have a new birth of freedom. And that the government of the people, by the people, and for the people, shall not perish from the earth. Please stand for the presentation of our colors.
Come, swimming to me, our thunder. More than 200 years have passed since the birth of our nation, and we find the world very different now.
And yet, as John Kennedy so clearly reminded us, those same revolutionary beliefs for which our forebears fought are still at issue today. The belief that the rights of man come not from the generosity of state, but from the hand of God. We dare not forget that we are heir to that first revolution.
Let the word go forth from this time and place to friend and foe alike, that the torch has been passed on to a new generation of Americans, born in this century, tempered by war, disciplined by a hard and bitter peace, and proud of our ancient heritage, unwilling to permit or witness the slow undoing of those human rights to which are so rightfully ours.
Let every nation know, whether it wishes us ill or well, that we will pay any price, bear any burden, meet any hardship, support any friend, oppose any foe, to assure the survival and success of liberty.
This much we pledge and more.
Today, as we reflect on the blessings of liberty, we pause to ask your help that we may be faithful stewards of the blessings of freedom that we have been granted. We remember your sobering words of Scripture, that to whom much is given shall much be required. We echo the words of President Reagan's prayer in his inaugural address, that you would continue to hold us close as we fill the world with our song, a song of unity, affection, and love. May we remain one people under God, dedicated to the dream of freedom that you have placed in the human heart. Amen.
Truly be our own.
Yes, we are.
bless America.